hand, but I'm holding what I am, the wheel.
I'm Terry Allen, and I'm an artist and songwriter.
Cool. Could you tell us, when did you start taking interest in any kind of writing?
Probably in junior high school. I remember I started keeping a notebook, and why I started keeping a notebook, I don't know, because no one in my family kept notebooks, and I didn't even know what notebooks were about.
Yeah.
But I would write what I wanted to be in it, and ultimately I really didn't want to be anything, you know, which I proved in high school, for sure. You know? But I would write artist, writer, musician. Then the next week I would put musician, writer, artist. Then I'd put writer, you know. So it was constantly kind of changing. And I had no concept of what those three things really were, other than my mother was a musician. And I was starting to read some of the Beat writers.
What? Do you remember?
Kerouac.
Of course.
Pretty much, Kerouac is who I read first, and then Ginsberg. I read some of his stuff and some of Burroughs, but that was a little later on. And then Hemingway. I started reading Hemingway, and maybe that might be where the notebook came from. I remember For Whom the Bell Tolls, kept a notebook. I think he was writing armaments in it or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I like that idea of having something that you put ideas or thoughts down in, even though I'm not sure I had any ideas or thoughts at that time. But and then my father. He was a baseball player, but he was like 60 when I was born. Anyway, my dad was too old to play ball when I was born, but in his mind, he was always a baseball player. He bought an old defunct Four Square Gospel Church and started throwing dances in Lubbock, and. So there was a music connection kind of right there. Then he also got the wrestling promotership and became a wrestling promoter. And kind of over most of my childhood became kind of the local promoter and entrepreneur in town, bringing in entertainment. And so some of the very first rock and roll shows came in. And there was always kind of a huge overload of words kind of in my family, mostly from my mother. She was like a great storyteller, but my dad was a really good storyteller too. So I don't know if I think that just kind of by osmosis I got this love for language, just listening to my family but also I've related, I think, from the time I was like 6 years old, I sold setups out at the Jamboree Hall, which was my dad's wrestling arena. But on Friday nights, it was all, he had all black dances because Lubbock was very segregated at that time. And people like B.B. King, when he was called Blues Boy King, T-Bone Walker, kind of all of these, Jimmy Reed, all of these great players that were, they were really just kind of itinerant musicians moving from town to town in their station wagon. You know? Mm-hmm. And then the next night was the same, except it was all white. It was called Saturday Night Jamboree. and people like Ernest Tubb and Hank Williams and, wow, and Kitty Wells and all. So from the beginning, all of these, you know, I was exposed to these incredible people that I didn't know it, and obviously until retrospect, until, you know, but so there was that kind of, there was a feeling in our house about that you can make things, you can play music, and it, there was a tolerance that was like kind of a, you know, an island in a vast ocean of right-wing shit, mm-hmm, you know, that I kind of grew up in. Even though they weren't specifically tolerant, you know, it's like my mother had been expelled from SMU. She was the first woman expelled from SMU for playing jazz in Deep Ellum. But this was in the 20s, and then, but it was an all-black band that she was playing jazz, which was like just unspeakable in those days.
Yeah.
For a white, young white girl to play with a black band. So she went to Fort Worth, went to beauty school during the day to have, so she learned a day job and worked a band at night. And when she got the band together, they headed for California. So there was that kind of lack of fear, you know, about following something, which was also there. There was one picture on the wall in our house, and it was of a ship. I've got it in my studio in there. That's it's an etching of just this ship, and so visually it was pretty much your imagination or nothing, you know, because there was nothing to look at, except I know my uncles on my mother's side were heavily tattooed.
Tattooed,
yeah. They were all Navy people, Merchant Marine people in World War I, World War II. And I can remember sitting in the dirt at their, when they would all come in the summertime and barbecue and drink beer and sit with their undershirts and shorts and, you know, bullshit. But I can remember sitting in the dirt tracing like hula girls and panthers and all these incredible images on their legs and on their arms and their backs and stuff. One of my uncles had a tattoo of a longhorn steer that the head was like his whole torso, and rabbits came running out of his nose around his waist. And the steer's eyes were about where his nipples were, but the horns tipped at his wrist so that when he did that, he had this full, and it's awesome, like done somewhere in the Philippines.
Yeah.
You know, and beautiful drawing as I remember it, you know.
Well, as a kid, did you have any favorite writers that you got hooked on, or?
I loved comic books, yeah, and I loved classic comic books.
Yes.
And there wasn't like, I wasn't aware of reading so much until high school, when you almost had to be a closet reader unless you played ball or something, you know, which is a classic Texas Southern kind of, I know Larry McMurtry's written about that thing in Archer City of kind of hiding, reading a book, which gives it a whole other kind of power, you know. But I know when I was a kid, I loved comic books, and I loved those classic comic books. In fact, I think that was the beginning of any kind of classical education that I yearned to have, which I'm just now, the last several years, have been trying to get caught up, you know, during the summertime, reading the Russians, reading the Iliad, the Odyssey, only stuff that I remember is in comic books, you know. Yeah. And I also, the beat thing encouraged me. I wanted to do that. I wanted to do that speed, you know, language, that speed of language. And I remember I had an English teacher named Mrs. Murphy and when I was a sophomore in high school, and we were doing Shakespeare, and she was at the front of the class, and we were supposedly following her in the book as she was, you know, had her yardstick and doing whatever. And I was writing in my mind, a beatnik poem, you know. I was writing something, you know, just this outlandish gibberish, you know. But she stopped the class and she said, "You stand up and you read what you're writing," you know. And I thought, oh shit, you know. So here I read, you know, I start reading this thing. And when I finished, you know, I looked up at her and she said, "You keep doing that," you know. And it's like kind of the first permission that I ever remember about making something like that, whether it was writing or whatever, you know. Because the idea of music for me at that time was just something to push every limit and get thrown out of school, you know. I mean, it was always some way music put me in jeopardy. So did making art put me, you know. I used to draw in people's notebooks, porno drawings for a quarter, and I got caught in that. And so I was actually kicked out of school for singing my own song on an assembly that I had tried out with a Bo Diddley song, and my song was a Roman orgy, and so I was expelled for singing that song, and then I got expelled for doing these dirty drawings. So
two badges of honor.
Yeah, it's funny. It's like that's what I ended up doing. You know,
yeah.
I think also rock and roll was huge in those little rural areas in the 50s, because it was the first time that you got a sense of a door out, you know. And also with language, you know, like Chuck Berry's songs were really good songs, yeah. You know. I mean, you think about some of those songs that were, I mean, some of them were just drivel, granted, but like, you know, people like, I know one of my earliest memories in the car, and I think everybody that grew up in that part of the country, is late at night getting on a farm road and turning up the radio as loud as it would go and driving it as fast as it would go. And it was inevitably Wolfman Jack.
Bingo.
But nobody knew who he was. Nobody knew what he was.
Where
we knew it was coming out of Mexico, you know, because we knew it was coming out of Del Rio, which, but the transmitter was in Cunha, which is right across the border, you know. But anyway, that was the first exposure to like Delta blues, you know, rhythm and blues. A lot of music that we just had, none of us had any kind of access to.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, it was a huge influence, I think, on a huge motivator as far as like that rush of speed and words and sounds and music. And
when did you get in to take off on the songwriting? When did you get serious about that?
Really, I didn't until, you know, I started writing a few songs in high school, and there was a friend, a guy named David Box, who was a real interesting story, because David was the first lead singer to sing with the Crickets after Buddy Holly got killed. And David and I were Joe Harvey, we were all in art class together, you know. And when I did this Roman Archie song, I did it with David because he was also kicked out of school. But we kind of ran back to the back, changed into togas and ran out. And then, you know, I played piano, he was playing guitar and sang this idiotic song, you know, which our peers loved and the powers that be hated, I guess. You know? But that was kind of the first person I ever played music with, was David Boggs. And David, you know, ironically, he had a big hit with that was starting to build with Peggy Sue Got Married, which was right after, it was the first recording
that, was that
the Crickets did.
Oh.
Yeah, well, Buddy Holly did it, but he, David did, it didn't, kind of didn't do anything with Buddy Holly, but it kind of got overshadowed, I think, by his death and all of that stuff. So they recut it with David singing it. He was flying to Dallas to do a radio promo and was killed in a plane crash, you know. So it was just like, the Crickets said, no more flying, you know.
Wasn't Waylon Jennings part of that group?
He was part of the yeah, he flipped a coin with Big Bopper.
Yeah.
And literally, that's what happened. He flipped a coin with Big Bopper.
And won.
And won, yeah. And you know, the thing that they never talk about, but the reason that they left that night is that they'd been on the road for so long, and Buddy Holly wanted to get a jump on the next place they were going to do his wash. You know, he hadn't washed his clothes in like weeks.
Oh,
you know,
yeah, that's
and that's what that was about. You know? Now, what happened? I started, and when rock and roll hit, I just craved to play an instrument, and my mother was a piano player, and we had a piano in the house. So I said, "Will you, you know, teach me how to play the piano?" And so she sat down and she taught me how to play the St. Louis Blues. That was and literally said, "Now you're on your own," you know. So that's kind of what I started from, you know. Anyway, after high school, which I had done totally terrible at, I did get into Texas Tech for one semester. And I failed everything at Texas Tech, except I didn't want to be anything. Everybody I knew really kind of had a bead on wanting to be something, you know. And I, you know, my son's similar. You know, when he was a little kid, I asked him what he wanted to be, and he said, "I want to be a horse." And I was kind of the same way. I wanted to be a car.
Four on the floor, please.
Yeah, right. But I had a drawing class and I had a writing class. And those are the only two classes that I did well in. It was the only two classes I hardly went to. But I asked the teacher of the drawing class if there was a school that was like that class. And he told me about Chouinard Art Institute in L.A. And I basically was gone before the application got there. You know, I got out as quick as I could. And went out for 6 months and worked and kind of, I was on probation because my transcripts were so horrible. Then I went to, when I was in school the whole folk music thing hit in the early 60s. Mm-hmm. But Dylan had a huge, you know, Dylan changed everything, I think. You know, he changed everything because simply by merging, you know, loving to read, loving to play, whatever, you know. You know, I think that had a huge impact on the whole culture. And then I had some wonderful teachers there, English teachers, people that taught, that like all of the academic teachers that came in, taught for a couple of hours in the morning to pick up extra bucks. They were teaching like at UCLA or some other school or whatever. But that was the first exposure I had to books, to like really lists of books and names of books. And that combined with, I think, what was going on just with the times was It made you want to write. It made you want to draw. It made you want to
create.
Play music. It made you want to do. I know there was a friend of mine that rented a big house, a big old rundown house on Beaudry Street in L.A. And they found in the basement a full working little theater, like 50 seats with a little midget kind of fly space. And so we started doing performances in there once a week. We'd take turns writing them, we'd take turns doing the sets, we'd take turns doing the music. Everybody switched off, but everybody worked on their own, and then take turns, you know, performing in them. So that was my kind of introduction to theater, you know, which has been something I've always been interested in, you know, that yeah. idea of, and it's really about language for me, the theater, more than the panorama, the sprawl of the visual sprawl of it, you know, though I like that too. But yeah, LA was like just such a fertile, and especially coming from Lubbock, where you're just so void kind of in your mind, void of everything. But it was like that Tom Waits song, you know, you never see a place until you go back, you know, and that's kind of what happened with Lubbock for me. You know, I dearly hated it, deeply hated it.
What was your first published piece of art or writing or whatever, the kind of thing where you can stand back and say, oh yeah?
I guess it was the first published thing I ever looked at was probably an announcement for a show, first exhibition, you know, having I take it back. I had a poem in a school paper that was published.
Yeah.
It was Words as Birds, They Fly High, Fall and Die, blah, 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 something like that, you know. Just got filthier and filthier. <You know?
laughs> I'm receiving a pattern here, Terry.
The first song I ever wrote, which was in L.A. in 62, it was the first song I ever wrote that I thought was a song. This is a song. It's called Redbird, and it's kind of about New Orleans. And but that there was a member there in the student lounge. It was an old beat up upright at the school, and I would go in there whenever I could and play. And then we, you know, like music was just in the air all of the time. And a group of friends and I, we formed a band called the Black Wall Blues Quintet. And we basically did cover songs of Muddy Waters and kind of the blues guys. But we wrote a few of our own songs. And I didn't really start writing kind of, I did a body of, when I got out of school, I was hopelessly broke, which most kids I guess are, but I remember it, like an art degree was like, wasn't even decent toilet paper. I got out of school and I was, the band had completely disintegrated after I lost all the equipment. But got out of school and I just started writing songs. And I always read, I've always read a lot. And part of it, I think, is self-consciousness that I was so, that I didn't take advantage of so many things that I could have to get it started right, to go toward, you know, learning things that I just never had the opportunity to learn.
Yeah. And started getting serious about your songwriting then. Were you?
Well, I think too, school was the first time I'd ever been around people that to make a picture was dead serious. To write a story was for real, you know. It wasn't like just something you did to, you know, to get a grade or something like that. This was, and it was the first time that it really occurred to me that you could, this could be a life, you know. And I think that's, it wasn't the idea of a vocation or a career or any of those kind of words. It was like a choice of how you were going to conduct your life, how you were going to live. And once you stepped into that, everything you were, you know, worried about or whatever got focused in, because you really knew you didn't have any money. You really knew what you needed to get a space. You really knew what you needed to buy materials or to find a keyboard or whatever. You know, it all became very real. Until then, it was just, I think, kind of a cloud. You know? So, and I don't know exactly when that happened. I know I never wanted to teach. I only wanted to, and most of my friends by that time were, they just wanted to get out and get a studio and start making work and start or get a band together. And I had several friends that wanted to just try to get published, you know, because everybody was kind of in a lot of different, coming from a lot of different places. And also the 60s, it was a time when everything was merging, like dancers were working with painters, sculptors were working with actors, you know, I mean, all of these kind of labels were collapsing, I think. But music was a huge impetus for me, because it was really the most volatile form of expression that was going on in the 60s.
You know? One of the things I like about yours is just you're a storyteller. You got stories in your music, which country western tends to do anyway, ballads.
I think that's language and pictures and dramas and all of that. Really, it's about stories. It's about people telling one another stories, you know, in some way or another. I think of what I do more than anything is tell stories.
Asking you how you write seems to me really ridiculous. I get more interested in the fact that you create. You're doing graphic arts, you're doing music, you're doing writing, basically art is this full thing. Do you have a...
But I never think of it, I don't think it is separate.
Yeah,
I've always thought of it. I keep millions of notebooks, you know.
So you still have kept your notebooks?
I have.
You don't have that first one, do you?
I don't think I do. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of debris in my life, you know, strewn out across the clock.
Yeah.
But I still do that. It's just kind of an extension now, I think, of my...
Do you write daily?
I do something in that book daily. I come in here every day, and I'm here most of the day. Whether I'm reading, whatever I'm doing, but I have to be there, you know. It's like that Flannery O'Connor, that great comic, you know.
Yeah.
I go and I sit there, and if nothing happens, it doesn't happen. But if it does happen, I want to be there. You know, there's always such a, not really an overlap, but they inform one another, you know. The idea of making images and making music or words that go with music. My songs are real visual, I think.
Yeah.
You know? But I think images have a lot to do with language too, you know. So it's really one thing to me. And difficulty has always been an issue with people talk about how a pop song is probably not that hard, or a little country waltz or whatever. But it's just as difficult for me to make a song and get, you know, put a song together as it is to put a sculpture together, to put a theater piece together, whatever, you know. Because it's all trying to go to some place that's beyond a little bit your habits from before, you know. So every time you do it, it's the first time.
We're going through a profound change due to internet and technology and high tech and pixels and all of that kind of stuff, and it's changing just about everything. Do you have any insights that you've been pondering about changes in writing or music, given what's going on?
Yeah, to me.
And with the culture, too.
Yeah. It's about the loss of tactile, to me, you know. The fact that you...
The loss of tactile.
Yeah, that you don't have paper to hold, you know. You don't have... I don't know, like cutting. You used to cut and splice tape when you made a CD, you know. You edited by cutting and splicing, so you physically held it, just like old moviolas when they made film, you know. They cut it and they spliced it and they ran it through. But it was all about the hand. It was about hands doing this, you know.
Yeah.
And so in a sense, when you made a movie, you were making sculpture. When you made an audio tape, you know, or an album, you made a sculpture because you cut and spliced and put it together. And I miss that, you know.
Really want to thank you very, very much for taking this time.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I'm honored that you guys would ask me to do it.
You are so cool. Just in terms of taking the creative impulse and just making it happen in every direction, that's wonderful.
Yeah.